Hi guys, welcome to my retrospective on Hercules, the legendary journeys. Just a disclaimer before we begin, I don't own any rights to Hercules, the legendary journeys. I've pieced this together in some of my downtime as a hobby. Any ad revenue generated by this video goes to the copyright holders. This is also a fairly in-depth look into Hercules, the legendary journeys, and there will be some spoilers along the way. So let's get into it. Hercules, the Legendary Journeys, aired from early 1995 until late 1999, having a six-season run. The series was greenlit after the Hercules, the Legendary Journeys TV movies were well received by Universal Studios and during their original airing throughout 1994. The 1990s saw a surge in Herculean content, as there were various other Hercules projects released throughout the decade, mostly in cartoon form, such as the classic Disney animated Hercules movie from 1997. Hercules, the Legendary Journeys became a smash hit, spawning two spin-off shows, and at one point was the most watched TV show in the world when it passed Baywatch in the global ratings. The Legendary Journeys of Hercules began in 1993 when Universal Studios greenlit the production of four TV movies of Hercules as part of the Universal Media Action Pack. The series was created by Christian Williams and was produced by Sam Raimi and Robert Tappert. Each of the four movies take the half-god, half-mortal Hercules on a different adventure, accompanied by a different traveling companion to various locations throughout ancient Greece. With each new adventure, Hercules must use his godlike strength to foil Hera's plans to meddle with mankind. Hera is Hercules' stepmother and the queen of the Greek gods. Hera despises Hercules as he is the product of her husband Zeus's unfaithful relations with a mortal woman, and uses each scenario as an opportunity to destroy Hercules. It was decided to shoot the movies in New Zealand, and various national parks and private property in and around Auckland were used as filming locations. The move started a big trend in using New Zealand to film TV and cinema, as the Lord of the Rings and Hobbit franchises have been shot there since. The cast and crew would prove to be a healthy mix of both US and New Zealand-based talent throughout the entire franchise. American actor Kevin Sorbo ended up being cast as Hercules after being asked to callback auditions more than half a dozen times. At 6 feet, 3.5 inches tall and in great shape, Kevin was ideal for the role of Hercules. The producers were not looking for an Arnie-like muscle man, but more of a genuine jock type of guy to bring Hercules to life. Kevin had recently made it to the final two candidates for the role of Superman in the Lois and Clark series, before being beaten by Dean Cain, and was more than ready to land his breakout role. However, it was the casting of two-time Academy Award-winning actor Anthony Quinn as Hercules' father and king of the Greek god Zeus that really got the project some respectable street cred. Zeus plays a brief but vital role in each of the movies, quickly turning up to lend Hercules a helping hand while also being a hesitant and overprotective father who constantly tries to discourage Hercules from getting involved in Hera's affairs. The movies were shot throughout 1993 and aired on television throughout 1994. 1994 was a great year for TV and cinema, as Friends and ER also made their debut on our small screen. The world of cinema saw the release of countless classics like Forrest Gump, The Shawshank Redemption, Pulp Fiction, Speed, Maverick, The Mask, and Dumb and Dumber, among others. The movie titled Hercules and the Amazon Women was the first of the series. Hercules and his best friend Aeolus, played by New Zealand Shakespearean actor Michael Hurst, travel to a small, all-male village under attack by ferocious beasts. When the pair encounter the beasts, however, they discover that the beasts are in fact the former women of the village who have abandoned the men to pursue lives as Amazons under the influence of Hera. After Aeolus is killed in battle and Hercules is captured, he must find a way to free the Amazon leader Hippolyta, played by Roma Downey, from Hera's grip, bring the men and women back together, and find a way to save Aeolus with the help of Zeus. As a series opener, the script does make sense. Zeus cheated on Hera with Hercules' mortal mother, Alcmene, and therefore Hera convinces a village of women to turn on the men in their lives. But I will say I do find the final resolve to be weak for a series premiere, as it just feels like the writers took the easy way out with the cliche of going back in time. Unless time travel is the main focus of a script, I don't like it when it's used to resolve things, as it just feels like a cheap fix, especially when there's no consequence for doing so. That's why even though I love the original Superman film, the ending has never sat well with me. Even though they did throw in Superman breaking the rules and interfering with human history to try and strengthen the stakes, it was redundant because there were no consequences. The second installment, titled Hercules and the Lost Kingdom, aired 1 week later. This time, Hercules must help a group of people that have been banished from their home, the lost city of Troy, by Hera and her minion, the Blue Priest, played by New Zealand actor Nathaniel Lees. On the journey to Troy, Hercules encounters a young woman named Deianira, played by Renee O'Connor, who turns out to be the princess of Troy and is being stalked by the Blue Priest as Hera has wanted her as a human sacrifice since her birth. After the death of her father and the realization that she is the reason why her people have been driven from their kingdom, Deianira willingly walks into the grasp of the Blue Priest to offer herself as a sacrifice just as Hera wants. Hercules and the people of Troy must now take back their kingdom by force and save Deianira from her sacrificial death. This is probably my favourite Hercules movie. I feel the script is stronger than the first one, and all the actors give very strong performances in their roles. The third installment, titled Hercules and the Circle of Fire, aired later on in 94. This time, Hera is out to eliminate the entire human race by stealing the Eternal Torch from Prometheus and destroying all fire throughout the world. Hercules once again teams up with a woman named Deianira, played by the late Tawny Katane. As their journey progresses, Hercules and Deianira grow closer and consider beginning a romantic relationship, until a girl working for Zeus meddles in their relationship in an attempt to stop Hercules from pursuing retrieval of the Eternal Torch. Zeus reveals to Hercules that Hera has surrounded the torch with a circle of fire powerful enough to kill immortals. When Hercules still insists on attempting to reach the torch, Zeus stands in his way and refuses to let him pass. Hercules must now get past the powers of his father and reach the torch before it dies in order to save Deianira and all of humanity from freezing to death. The following week saw the airing of the fourth installment, titled Hercules in the Underworld. Hercules is now happily married to Deianira and has 3 children. Hercules has lost interest in battling Hera and just wants to live the life of a family man. Hera is not willing to let Hercules off that easily and devises a plan with the centaur, Nessus, played by New Zealand actor Cliff Curtis, who's since gone on to make a name for himself in Hollywood. They plan to drive Hercules mad enough to jump into the underworld by cursing a cloak that Hercules was given by Deianira. Grief and guilt-stricken Deianira is then tricked into taking her own life to be reunited with Hercules. Insistent that neither he nor Deianira will be staying in the underworld, Hercules makes a deal with Hades in which he will earn their freedom by catching the guard dog Cerberus and returning him to his post on Hades' behalf. This was originally going to be the end of the Hercules franchise, but as it turned out, there was still much more to come. Executives at Universal were so impressed by what they saw during production of the 4 movies that they decided to add a 5th movie to the mix. This installment was titled Hercules in the Maze of the Minotaur and aired in late 1994. The tone of the movie was to be a little different than the first 4. This time around, the main antagonist wasn't going to be Hera, but rather a monster that lives beneath the town of Altoria that has just been accidentally freed from his prison and is linked to Hercules in a way which Hercules could never have expected. Hercules teams up with Aeolus once again as they travel to Altoria to confront the Minotaur, who wants to kill Hercules as a way to get revenge on Zeus for trapping him underground for over 100 years. The film was also used as a clip show of highlights from the other 4 installments as Hercules and Aeolus reflect on some of their most memorable adventures on their way to Altoria. With all 5 Hercules TV movies well received throughout 1994, everything was on track for a weekly series of the franchise to commence in early 1995. With Hercules a settled-down family man by the end of the movies, the character needed to be thrown back into the adventure-thirsty mindset for the series to proceed. The decision was made to kill off Hercules' wife and children and force him to leave the quiet family life behind. Understandably, Anthony Quinn, who was 80 years old at the time, was not interested in continuing his role as Zeus for the series, and therefore his final appearance in the franchise was in Hercules in the Maze of the Minotaur. In the first TV episode titled The Wrong Path, Hera sends a fireball down to Hercules' house that engulfs Deianira and the kids when Hera finds out that Zeus has once again had relations with another woman. Hercules blames Zeus for his inaction to save his family, thus causing a huge rift between Hercules and Zeus, and riding out Zeus, Deianira and the kids from any immediate storylines. Hercules' family only make two more appearances throughout the show in Season 2 and Season 3, while Zeus doesn't appear again until Seasons 3, 4 and 6, and is played by a different actor every time he resurfaces. With these characters removed from the permanent spot on the series, it essentially made Hercules a one-man show. Although Michael Hirst did eventually become a series regular in the later seasons, he was originally also only considered to be a guest star. Although Hercules and Aeolus were the only two characters to have a permanent position on the show, we were introduced to plenty of great, memorable, reoccurring characters along the way, including Robert Trebor from Hercules and the Lost Kingdom, who returns to play a new character, Salmonius, Bruce Campbell as Autolycus, Alexandra Tidings as Aphrodite, Kevin Smith as Iphicles and Ares, Joel Toback as Strife and Deimos, Megan Desmond as Discord, Hudson Like as Callisto, Jeffrey Thomas as Jason, Liddy Holloway as Alcamene, and Carl Urban as Cupid and Julius Caesar, who has since gone on to become an international star in his own right. It was decided that the 5 double-episode-length movies plus the 13 TV episodes would come together to make the first season of Hercules. The TV series follows a simple formula, in which after getting past the immediate grief of losing his family, Hercules hits the road of ancient Greece and never gets very far without running into or being tracked down by someone who needs his help. Usually the problems that Hercules must help take care of are the work of Hera. However, there are other troublemakers along the way, like the Greek god of war Ares, as well as various mortals who just need to be put back in line. Yes, that is a young and then unknown Lucy Liu. Hercules' final encounter for Season 1 is that of the warrior princess, Xena, portrayed by New Zealand actress Lucy Lawless, who wants Hercules eliminated so she can head her army and rule the world. Xena makes 3 appearances in Season 1. At first, she comes across as a cold-hearted monster, but given time and her encounter with Salmonius and then being betrayed by her own army, she and Hercules find some common ground. Xena decides to join Hercules, Aeolus, and Salmonius to defeat the new leader of Xena's army, Darphus, who has been armed with the power of Ares, and his dog, Gregus. Hercules' inner goodness unchains Xena's heart, and realizing that she never wants to return to the person she was, leaves the others at the end of the season to start her own journey of redemption. This is where the first spin-off series of Hercules, Xena the Warrior Princess, begins, with Xena making her way through Greece trying to redeem herself, accompanied by her new companion Gabrielle, played by Renee O'Connor from Hercules and the Lost Kingdom. My top 3 episodes for Season 1 would have to be Episode 6, As Darkness Falls, where Nemus, the twin brother of Nessus, who is also played by Cliff Curtis, prays to Hera, seeking revenge against Hercules for his brother's death, as well as her help to possess the object of his affection, Penelope. Nemus's prayers are answered when Hera arms him with a power club to use against Hercules. Lucy Lawless also appears in this episode, playing Lila, Penelope's former best friend who now spends her time with the centaurs. Lila manages to drug Hercules with a substance causing temporary blindness, and when Nemus kidnaps Penelope from her own wedding, Hercules must retrieve her from the armed Nemus without his sight. Episode 7, Pride Comes Before a Brawl, where Aeolus' pride takes a hit after Hercules bails him out of a brawl. Insisting that his way to Thrace is quicker than Hercules' way, Aeolus decides to split from Hercules and prove that his path is quicker. However, it doesn't take Aeolus long to encounter the maiden, Lydia, played by Lisa Chappell, who would go on to star in the Australian drama MacLeod's Daughters. Lydia informs Aeolus that the road is filled with satyrs. While on his path to Thrace, Hercules is reunited with his first love, Nemesis, who delivers justice for the gods. Nemesis reveals to Hercules that she has been sent to kill a man named Aeolus at the order of Hera as punishment for his pride, arrogance, and ego. Nemesis tells Hercules that he can't help Aeolus. If Aeolus is to live, then he must get himself out of the trap that's been laid for him. And episode 11, The Vanishing Dead, where the bodies of dead soldiers are mysteriously disappearing. Hercules is horrified when he learns that Dolan and Poena, siblings that Hercules knew as kids, have now grown up to wage war on each other. Determined to reunite the broken family, Hercules and Aeolus set out to discover who or what is responsible for this family war and the link to the missing bodies of the dead. The answer may lie with Ares and Hercules' old friend Jarton, who seems to know more than he's letting on. The season 2 premiere aired on September 4, 1995, the same night as the season 1 premiere of Xena. Fans of the Hercules franchise now had two shows to watch from the same universe, and it didn't take long for the support characters in Hercules to start popping up in episodes of Xena and vice versa. This is pretty common practice in our days, with all the current TV shows of the DC universe continually mixing with each other. But in the late 90s, this was something that audiences hadn't seen much of before. Season 2 follows a similar path to Season 1, with Hercules having to journey to different locations in ancient Greece to save the citizens from a variety of evil, usually instigated by Hera. Hercules is usually accompanied by either Aeolus or Salmoneus on his travels, as the name Hercules becomes more and more legendary. My top three episodes for season 2 are episode 5, Outcast, where Hercules and Salmoneus must come to the aid of Derek and Lila. After sparing Hercules' life against Nemesis, Derek and Lila decide to move on and relocate to a new town where they are met with nothing but bigotry. After the family home is destroyed and Lila killed, Derek seeks revenge on those responsible. When Hercules and Salmoneus arrive at the town, the citizens try to convince them that Derek has gone insane, but they aren't convinced and agree to help bring Derek in so that they can uncover the real truth. Episode 21, The Wedding of Alcmene, where Hercules' mother reveals she intends to marry one of Hercules' oldest friends, the King of Corinth and the Argonaut, Jason. After saving Jason from his own inner demons earlier in the season, Jason's life is back on track and he feels he will be complete once becoming Alcmene's husband, even if he has to give up his crown to do so. Hercules isn't supportive at first, but Aeolus persuades Hercules to look at how happy the two of them are, and he gives them his blessing. Meanwhile, Nathaniel Lees returns as the Blue Priest when Hera resurrects him to turn the wedding of Alcmene into the death of Hercules. The episode is a great reunion of many of the characters we have gotten to know over the past almost two seasons. And episode 23, Centaur Mentor Journey, where it's revealed that Hercules' childhood mentor, the centaur Ceridian, is dying. Ceridian seeks Hercules' help to bring home the troubled centaur Cassius, who is waging war on humans because the local magistrate banned centaurs from their town. Determined to play peacemaker, Hercules braves both angry parties to try to restore the peace, while attempting to convince Cassius to return to Ceridian's side, so that Ceridian can pass on to the other side in peace. Season 3 premiered on September 30, 1996, along with Season 2 of Xena. As a general note, Season 3 is quite like Season 2 in regards to script quality and production value. The stories continue in the same vein as what we have seen previously. As the saying goes, if it ain't broke, don't fix. The big event of season 3 would be the Golden Hind trilogy from episodes 13 to 15. This was a storyline where Hercules and Aeolus must assist in saving the last remaining Golden Hind, who is being hunted and who considers herself to be a loyal servant of Ares. While pursuing the Hind, Hercules encounters the beautiful Serena, who has the power to heal. Hercules and Serena are very taken with each other, and it doesn't take long for them to fall in love. Ares stages a coup that will only allow Hercules to be with Serena if he surrenders his strength and power. Hercules agrees and commences married life with Serena, once being reduced to a complete mortal and fulfilling his part of the bargain. But if Hercules thinks that Ares will stick to his part of the bargain, he has another thing coming. The Golden Hind trilogy was a significant part of the show for various reasons. It's the first time since Xena that a Hercules story was played out across multiple episodes, and it's the first time we see Ares in the form of the late actor Kevin Smith on the show. By this time, Kevin had already played Ares on Xena a handful of times while playing Iphicles on Hercules. Production of the trilogy was also of personal significance for Kevin Sorbo. Cast in the role of Serena was Sam Jenkins. Sam had had an earlier role in the season in which she also had romantic moments with Hercules. Kevin was taken with Sam straight away and realized that production of the trilogy would be the perfect opportunity to get to know her better and tee up a potential date. Sam claimed she wasn't that taken with Kevin at first, but he kept pursuing her and before long the two were inseparable. Kevin and Sam married on January 5, 1998 and are still happily married today with their three kids. My top three episodes for season three are episode one, Mercenary, where Hercules becomes stranded on a deserted island with Dirk, a man wanted for murder after the prison ship they were on gets caught in a storm. Hercules intends to pursue Dirk and bring him back to the mainland for trial, while Dirk is determined to overcome the injured Hercules and escape. While the two men hunt each other, they soon realize that they are both being hunted by a band of pirates, and then all parties realize that they are being hunted by the monstrous sand rays that live below the surface of the island. It's a great season opener that keeps the viewer on the edge of their seat. Episode 9, A Star to Guide Them, where Aeolus, a farmer, and a thief from separate backgrounds are all united after experiencing the same intense dream, and being exposed to the same side effects from having such a dream. All three men have an uncontrollable impulse to head north, but have no idea why. Accompanied by Hercules, they soon discover that King Polonius and his queen have ordered the capture and slaughter of all of the baby boys in the province, after a prophet informs them that a baby boy not of the bloodline will reign over the kingdom. At first, the men believe they were brought together to stop the royal pair and save the babies, but soon believe they may be a part of something even greater. They decide to follow a bright star in the night sky to a stable directly below, and while Hercules decides to watch from afar, the three others head for the stable, eager to see what miracle awaits them. I'm sure you've caught on by now, but if not, this was season 3's Christmas episode, and although I'm not what you'd call a religious man myself, I can't help but find this episode to be charming, magic, and really enjoyable. And episode 18, Reign of Terror, where the mad king Augeas believes he is Zeus. Augeas orders his servants to rededicate the nearby temple of Aphrodite to his wife, Hera. Aphrodite threatens to destroy the love lives of those involved until Hercules convinces her to let him figure out what's going on. Hera temporarily grants Augeas the powers of a god, and informs him that he will be able to keep the powers if he kills Hercules. This episode pulls on various heartstrings. It's dramatic with both tragic and comedic elements to the script, and really shines the spotlight on Aphrodite, showing us that, although temperamental, she has true inner beauty as well as outer beauty. September 29, 1997 saw the premiere of Season 4 of Hercules along with Season 3 of Xena, and this is where things get interesting. As a lot of Hercules fans will know, Kevin Sorbo suffered major health issues during the production of Season 4. While promoting the film Kull the Conqueror, Kevin began experiencing problems in his left arm and hand. It's a detailed story, but in short, Kevin had an aneurysm in his left shoulder, which ruptured and caused three strokes which affected his balance center and caused a 10% loss of vision in both eyes. You can read all about it in Kevin's book, True Strength. This obviously brought a real shock to the production system, as Kevin was banned from working under doctor's orders and then could only return to the set for for a couple of hours a day, instead of the 14 to 16 hour days he had been working before the medical episode. The team were then faced with the daunting task of figuring out how to keep the show going without their star. Various episodes of season 4 were written and produced with either no or very little appearance from Kevin. This was done very creatively through telling stories based on other characters in the show like Aeolus, Salmonius and Autolycus, while Hercules was off saving the day elsewhere. There are also a few episodes that are made up of flashbacks to Hercules' teenage years with actor Ian Bowen playing young Hercules. An episode where Hercules is temporarily recast after being turned into a pig, and even a modern-day spoof episode that focused on the current predicament, as the show's producers are left in a panic when their star actor mysteriously disappears. I do tip my hat to the creators of the series here, in the way that they were able to effectively manage such a bizarre and challenging situation. Season 4 also mixes things up a bit. This is the year where most of the Hercules and Xena story crossovers took place. Episodes 13 and 14, Armageddon Now, Parts 1 and 2, focus on the villains Hope and Callisto, who had already made names for themselves in Xena. The story takes place straight after the events of the Xena episode, Maternal Instincts. Hope and Callisto have now changed strategy and go after Hercules in order to get their revenge on Xena and Gabrielle. Their plans are temporarily prevented, and the duo would then resurface again in the episodes of Xena, Sacrifice Parts 1 and 2, where the events of Maternal Instincts and Armageddon Now come to their conclusion. My top episodes for Season 4 are Episode 10, Hercules on Trial, where a man pretending to be Hercules is killed while trying to perform a Herculean feat. This gives the prosecutor Spencius enough of a case to put the real Hercules behind bars, as he states that Hercules' inspirational effect on the common man puts them in great danger, claiming that there is no place for heroes in the world anymore, and that Hercules only disrupts the order of things. For those of you who have watched my Lois and Clark retrospective, you will know that I put the spotlight on an episode called Wine, Wine, Wine for very similar reasons. Trying to do what you feel is right, only for it to be thrown in your face, is something that most people experience somewhere along the line, and it's great when fantasy shows can incorporate relatable material into their storytelling. What's great about this episode is that we are reunited with a list of people that Hercules has helped throughout the series, and when being questioned on the stand, we are shown how easy one's words can be twisted to suit another's agenda. Episode 19, War Wounds, where civil war has erupted in Corinth between the townspeople and returning soldiers who are accused of being thugs who can't leave the fighting behind. King Iphicles has been sending troublemaking soldiers to Golgoth prison. The soldiers' leader, Ajax, who is an old friend of Hercules and Aeolus, resents the treatment of his comrades and takes Iphicles hostage to demand fair treatment. Hercules and Aeolus try to reinstate the peace on both sides, but once all parties are locked inside Golgoth, they must fight their way out through the infestation of sand sharks that hunt from below the surface. This is also an episode where the issues being addressed can be related to more modern times, and is another great example of the moral value that a lot of the Hercules scripts came with. And episode 22, Reunions, the season finale, where Hercules has decided to join Zeus on Olympus as a full god and try to mend the fractured relationship with his father after the death of his mother. It doesn't take Hercules long to come to the realization that Zeus has his own agenda for wanting Hercules on Olympus. For the first time in the series, we see Hera in the flesh as she is portrayed by Meg Foster. Hera reveals to Zeus that she has taken Alcmene's spirit from the Elysian fields, and she will suffer forever unless Zeus surrenders his godhood. It's then up to Hercules to stop Hera and her associates, Ares and Apollo. It's quite an impressive and action-packed episode to end the season on, and wraps up a lot of the story elements from the past. It was just a couple of weeks before the premiere of Season 5 that the second spin-off show from Hercules the Legendary Journeys hit our TV screens. Young Hercules debuted on September 12, 1998. After the handful of flashback episodes to Hercules' teen years in season 4 and the standalone Young Hercules feature film, it was decided to give Young Hercules his own series for Fox Kids. Dean O'Gorman and Chris Conrad reprised their roles as young Aeolus and young Jason. However, Ian Bowen decided not to remain in New Zealand to film the series, and so Young Hercules was recast with a then unknown Ryan Gosling. The series tells 20-minute stories of Hercules' adventures while studying at Chiron's Academy and features various already known characters like Ares, Strife, and Discord, as well as new characters that we would later see as adults in the main series like Lilith. Although the show had good ratings, it was not renewed after the airing of its first season, and a total of 50 episodes were produced. Season 5 sees Hercules' journey beyond the shores of ancient Greece as he meets both friends and foes in Sumeria, Ayr in ancient Ireland, and the ancient Norse land in Scandinavia, where Hercules comes face to face with the Norse gods, before the world only associated Thor with Chris Hemsworth. After the one god Dayhawk was temporarily prevented from entering the world in the previous season of Xena, he tries again with the help of the Sumerian king Gilgamesh, who uses and betrays Hercules in order to get his hands on the powerful nectar needed to overcome the Sumerian gods and release Dayhawk into the world. Hercules manages to stop Gilgamesh, but loses Aeolus in battle, making the season premiere the fourth time that Aeolus loses his life in the series, and this time it looks like it may be for good. After journeying to other foreign lands and having his faith in himself restored, Hercules considers staying in Ayr to pursue his new romance with Morrigan, who has recently become the Druid of Justice. They are interrupted when they discover that Dayhawk has found a way into the world, and even more shockingly, has been able to do so by inhabiting the body of the late Aeolus. Dayhawk travels to Greece and turns the public against Hercules by the time Hercules, Morrigan, and Nebula arrive to stop him. The Greek gods have fled the land through their fear of Dayhawk, so Hercules is left alone to not only rid the world of Dayhawk, but try and save Aeolus' soul in the process. This storyline alone plays out across the first 11 episodes of the season, and it was refreshing for the show to have had this progressive storyline instead of just a long line of standalone episodes strung together. My top three for season 5 are episode 8, Darkness Rising. While Hercules enjoys some downtime with Morrigan and her little daughter Bridget, Dayhawk manages to enter the world in Sumeria and haunt Nebula before travelling to Ayr and slaughtering the druids. Hercules sees all this in a dream vision and races to save the druids, but it's too late. Hercules and Morrigan travel to Sumeria to find that Nebula has been locked up after being driven mad. Nebula tells Hercules that she is being haunted by Aeolus' ghost and can't tell what's real and what's not. Hercules makes his way to the tombs to find that Aeolus' body is missing, right before coming face to face with his best friend once again. Only this time, it's far from a friendly encounter. Episode 17, The Academy, where Hercules and Jason are accompanied by the Aeolus of the Otherworld back to their old academy. Once they arrive, they are quick to realize that things have changed since the old days, and not for the better. The place seems to be controlled by a group of rebels from within the academic walls, and it's up to our heroes to weed out the good students from the bad. The guys are also reunited with Lilith from their days at the academy, who introduces them to her daughter Seska, and to the shock of everyone, Lilith then introduces Seska to her father, Jason. There is also a special appearance from Ryan Gosling in this episode as well. Although I have to say, that's the most artificial dyed hair and fake tan that I've ever seen. And episode 22, Revelations. Yep, once again I'm going with the season finale. To the delight of Hercules, Aeolus makes a surprise trip back to Earth, but their happy reunion must be put on hold as Aeolus warns Hercules that the end of the world is coming. The Archangel Michael arrives on Earth and sets out to locate the four seals that bring forth the four horsemen of the apocalypse. By the time Hercules and Aeolus catch up with Michael, he has already released the horsemen of war, pestilence, and famine. And if Michael isn't stopped from releasing the horsemen of death, then all hope is lost. Hercules and Aeolus receive a surprise helping hand from Ares of all people, and I must say that Kevin Smith's performance in this episode was hysterical. The final season for Hercules and Aeolus would be season 6. It's been said that the studio wanted to sign Kevin Sorbo for a further 3 seasons, but Kevin turned the contract renewal down as he'd been given the opportunity to go on and star in the sci-fi show Andromeda. Kevin's contract was up before an entire 6th season could be shot, and so the series wrapped just 8 episodes into the season with the finale, Full Circle, airing on November 22, 1999. Kevin Sorbo would actually make his final appearance as Hercules in the Xena episode, God-Fearing Child, which aired after the new year on February 5th, 2000. There's not much to say about season 6 other than it was short and sweet and we got to see most of our favourite characters one last time before saying goodbye, although many of these characters would continue to make appearances on Xena, which ran for a further year and a half, wrapping on June 18, 2001 and ending the franchise. By the time season 6 of Hercules hit our screens, Xena had well and truly become the more popular of the two shows, and I think it was the right decision to bring things to a nice clean close when they were. Being a part season, I've selected my top 2 episodes for season 6, and they are Episode 4, Darkness Visible, where an old friend of Hercules, Vlad, asks for his assistance in defeating the Strigoi. Once inside Vlad's castle, however, Hercules and Aeolus realize that they may have just entered the Devil's Lair. And Episode 6, City of the Dead, where the Queen of Egypt seeks Hercules and Aeolus' help in making peace with Greece. The Queen's children, however, wish to resurrect their country's warlike past. When Prince Ramses is caught red-handed by Hercules for treason and sentenced to death, the Queen helps him escape, pleading for Ramses to exile himself instead. But Ramses has other plans that could prove to be a lot more deadly. Although Hercules was, and still is, a very enjoyable show to watch, as far as genre goes, it's a difficult one to pigeonhole. The show is aimed at entertaining people of all ages, especially young families, but the tone of the series tends to get campier as it goes on. Seasons 3 and 4 feel as though they take themselves less seriously than what seasons 1 and 2 did, but then the death of Aeolus at the start of season 5 sees the show head down a darker path once again, while season 6 seems to go back to the camp. In its entirety, it's a family series, but the genre can change episode by episode. Some episodes take themselves quite seriously, while others are a complete spoof. There are even musical episodes along the way, where Hercules must dance or even model his way to the rescue. It got to a point where the audience really didn't know what to expect week to week. Since adulthood, I've become fonder of the spoof episodes, and I understand there were times during production, such as when Kevin was recovering, that it couldn't really be helped. But as a kid, I remember being quite disappointed after waiting a whole week only to be given a spoof or Herc-free episode to watch on that Saturday night. Hercules revolves around Greek mythology. However, being a family-friendly show, it had to be quite loosely based on that mythology. Anyone that knows Greek mythology knows how full of incest it is, and so it had to be altered to suit the younger audience. For example, it's never mentioned that Zeus and Hera are brother and sister, as well as husband and wife, like in the mythology, and Aphrodite's title was the goddess of love, as opposed to her title in the mythology, the goddess of lust. Just slight tweaks along the way to make the content more appropriate as well as understandable. If you read too far into all the relationship crossovers in Greek mythology, it can become quite confusing. The music for all the shows in the franchise was composed by Joseph LaDuca, who wrote some great stuff. There were 4 different soundtracks released for Hercules the Legendary Journeys, each focusing on different parts of the show's timeline. I particularly enjoy the first soundtrack, which features most of the music cues from the TV movies. The music is very nostalgic, and a lot of it still holds up quite well today. Copies of the soundtracks are fairly easy to find online in CD form, or you can purchase them as MP3 format from iTunes. The special effects used throughout the series vary in quality quite a bit. Understandably, none of the effects hold up today. After all, it was the 90s. TV budgets were limited and the technology was far from what it is today. But I'm talking more about the quality of special effects from episode to episode. Some episodes seem to have superior special effects compared to others. Perhaps certain effects were just a lot easier to create in the 90s than others. I'm not someone who is bothered by primitive special effects, and I'm sure a lot of my fellow 90s kids would agree. Each generation seems to accept the quality of special effects they're exposed to. I'm not sure how well Hercules would be received by the children of today, who are used to having everything looking 100% real. But for those of us who were kids in the 90s, it was usually easy enough for us to use our imagination to fill in the gaps between what looked fake and what looked real. In early 2002, the cast, crew, and fans of Hercules and Xena were shocked by the untimely death of Kevin Smith, only 6 months after completion of the franchise. Kevin had made a real name for himself while filming the series and had flown to Beijing to play a role in a US-Chinese martial arts film, Warriors of Virtue 2. According to reports, Kevin had completed his work on the film and then decided to go for a wander around the film studio, where he climbed a prop tower for another film and lost his footing, plummeting to the ground below. Kevin was rushed to hospital, where he died of head injuries sustained in the fall 10 days later without ever regaining consciousness. Kevin's body was flown back to Auckland, and he was buried during a private funeral. Kevin was one of my favourite actors as a kid, and I was able to pay my respects at his grave when I visited Auckland in 2018. At the time of his passing, Kevin had just been cast in his first Hollywood role, opposite Bruce Willis in Tears of the Sun. It's a real shame that Kevin never got to capitalize on his success from Hercules and Xena, but he is survived by his wife and three sons, and is well remembered all around the world for his memorable performance as the mighty God of War. The fight choreography throughout the show is pretty impressive. Yes, like everything else in the show, it probably wouldn't stand up today, and there are elements of it that do look over-exaggerated, but all in all, I think it holds up pretty well. While playing Hercules, Kevin Sorbo actually undertook martial arts training in order to make the fight scenes look as authentic as possible, and I think that's pretty obvious when you look at the fight scenes. You can tell just how hard he actually did work at the role of Hercules. The series shows its age now in a variety of ways, from the special effects and aspect ratio to the campy 90s nature of the scripts and fluctuating tone of the show. Television content has come a long way since the 90s. While a lot of the show wouldn't hold up critically today, it succeeded in capturing the imagination of an entire generation of kids, teenagers and young adults while on the air. I can vividly remember looking forward to Saturday nights in with my family as a kid to watch Hercules followed by Xena every week. I recall being very quick to spend my pocket money on the 5 movies when they were finally released on VHS. Well, on a few of them anyway. I wasn't allowed to watch the 2 that came with a mature rating for a while, and I remember being very frustrated because I couldn't complete my collection. My cousins even bought me a copy of the animated movie Hercules and Xena, The Battle for Mount Olympus, for my birthday 1 year. And while the Xena trilogy was also released on VHS, 2 of them also came with a mature rating, so I didn't really bother watching them until the DVD release years later. As a teenager, I purchased the DVD box sets of Hercules, Xena, and Young Hercules, and have watched them all numerous times in the years since. I still flick them on occasionally to take a trip down memory lane. Hercules and Superman were my 2 favourites growing up, and I learned a lot from both of those characters. That's something else I can say about this show, is that there was plenty of lessons to be learned for the kids who watched it. The scripts had great morale, with messages of anti-bullying and acceptance for children, without being patronising. There are also plenty of shake-your-head type laughs along the way. Examples of this is when Hercules and Aeolus have gone undercover, and Aeolus introduces them as Uranus and Plutonius from the Mineral Rights Movement, and when Salmonius yells at a man named Xerox for copying another's work during a painting competition. Hercules is a charming show of escapism that's good fun. delivering healthy combinations of entertaining content. It put New Zealand on the map in the world of film and television and started the superhero franchise crossover trend. It left its mark on an entire generation and is always a fun place to revisit from time to time when you're looking for a good escape. Thanks for watching.